This is Right to Life Radio. I am John Girardi. Thank you so much for being with us this morning. If you want to call in, the number is 442-1680. That is 442-1680. A lot to get to today. As you know, this is only a once-a-week show. We only show up on Thursday mornings, so I have to cover things that happened over the course of the previous week. And we're going to get to a lot today. There's a lot of different legislative developments. We're going to have a guest in studio, Pastor Tyrone Carter, who's going to talk about his work with Save the Black Family and talk about what it means to be a pro-life pastor and how he puts the pro-life message into his work, into his ministry, and how to encourage other pastors to do the same. But I wanted to lead off the show with kind of a significant death, actually, in the pro-life movement. On Saturday, Norma McCorvey passed away. Now, most of you probably don't really know who Norma McCorvey is, but you'd probably know her better as Jane Roe. She was the famous Roe of Roe v. Wade. Roe is sort of obviously it's kind of like John Doe, Jane Roe, for certain kinds of cases involving sensitive issues, for the sake of publication. If courts want to keep a person's name anonymous, they will use a name like John Doe or Jane Roe. So that was what happened in the course of this lawsuit, which attempted and successfully legalized abortion in all 50 states. So Norma McCorvey's story is actually a pretty interesting one, and it involves a lot of weird twists and turns. Norma lived in Texas, and back in the 1970s, she became pregnant with her third child. And she was not making a lot of great choices in life and was in a difficult place. And she wasn't in a great situation to have the child. So at that time in Texas, like most states, abortion was illegal, except in order to save the mother's life. So she didn't have any option to abort her child. She was discovered by lawyers who were looking for a kind of test case plaintiff to bring a case to seek the legalization of abortion. And they found her and sort of decided, okay, she's going to be the one, and they asked her to do it, and she said okay. But it was sort of interesting, and as a lawyer myself, I kind of see how sort of manipulative a lot of this was, that really her lawyers were sort of just using her as a vehicle to accomplish some ulterior goal, namely the legalization of abortion. Norma said later on that her lawyers were lying to her about the nature of abortion, were telling her that the baby was just a piece of tissue, and just saying it's nothing. You just missed your period. It's just a pregnancy. It's not a baby. There's no human there. Norma would claim, sort of in order to make her case more sympathetic, she claimed that she was pregnant due to rape, and this was sort of to make her seem like a more sympathetic plaintiff. She later admitted that no, she was not actually raped. And she wound up being kind of totally disengaged from her case. Her lawyers didn't really talk to her. She never testified in court. She signed an initial affidavit at the start of the process, but apparently she didn't even read it. So she was kind of completely separated from this whole process. And she was just, you know, some average Jane woman who had no idea about the enormous societal forces that were going to be unleashed as a result of her, you know, agreeing to be part of this lawsuit. So after the Roe v. Wade decision was issued, she began this very weird public life. During the 1980s, her name sort of became known, and people figured out who Jane Roe was. And she became a kind of pro-choice advocate, and she would do public speaking engagements and all for pro-choice stuff, all for pro-abortion stuff. She always felt conflicted about it, but apparently she said she needed money. And eventually she began to work for an abortion clinic. Well, this is sort of a very providential thing. This clinic wound up, its office space wound up getting another tenant, which was a pro-life pregnancy resource center. Which is a common thing. Most pro-life pregnancy resource centers try to set up shop as close to an abortion clinic as they possibly can in order to give women who are considering abortion the opportunity to go somewhere else very close by immediately. And Norma began to interact, because she was working in the same office building as these pro-lifers, she began to interact with them. And at first had some very hostile interactions, but soon, after a while, began to have a more friendly relationship with some of these people, and particularly with one family who had a young daughter, about young 6-7-year-old daughter, who made a very big impression upon Norma, and this family that she was interacting with started to make her think about her own life, her own choices, her own involvement in abortion, and made her think about, you know, what abortion actually was and what it was actually doing. And that girl's family sort of convinced Norma to return to a more active practice of her Christian faith. And eventually she would become a Roman Catholic. And this process sort of culminated in the 90s with Norma sort of, after she converted, taking a full turnaround position. She became actually a pro-life advocate and a very well-recognized pro-life speaker, and completely rejected what she had previously been advocating for. In fact, in 2003, she tried to reopen her own case, Roe v. Wade. She tried to reopen it by saying that she was the plaintiff in the case and that her attorneys had, you know, lied to her, that she didn't actually... That she was, you know, being misled, and that she wasn't actually advocating the things that her attorney said she was advocating for. Unfortunately, that didn't go anywhere. But it was, I mean, she tried her best to make amends for what had happened with her life. Now, one of the amazing things about her story is, so you remember in the 70s, Norma became the plaintiff in Roe v. Wade because she had a baby, she wanted to abort it, and the laws in Texas prevented her from aborting her baby. Well, what happened to that baby? Well, the fact is, abortion didn't get legalized before she was due. The court process of taking a case all the way from a district court all the way up to the Supreme Court, it takes longer than 9 months. And as a result, Norma wound up having her baby. She did not abort her baby. The baby that she was trying to, that her attorneys were trying to seek the legal right for her to abort, she didn't. She actually gave the child up for a closed adoption. And so right now, probably, there is a 43-year-old woman who was given to a family in probably in Texas back in the 1970s who's alive and completely ignorant of the circumstances of her birth. So she, in spite of the fact that she was advocating for, that her attorneys were advocating for death, she herself chose life. So it's, Norma's story, I think, is a really powerful one. It's a real testament to, first, I think, the love and mercy of God, that, you know, someone even who has done something as wrong as Norma did, participating in something that was so monumentally evil, that, you know, God will leave the 99 to go look for that one lost sheep. And he did with her. And I think it's also a testament to the kindness and love that is so often seen within the pro-life movement, that it's never been a movement about shaming women who've had abortions. It's always been a movement about love and about reaching out to those who are hurting, to those who are in need, because so many women, you know, they're not choosing abortion because, you know, they're in the full, you know, exercise of their freedom and they're in some great place in their life. No, usually when women choose abortion, it's an awful decision, and it's because it's the very last option that they think they have. And our responsibility at Right to Life of Central California and other pro-life ministries in this valley is to reach out to these women and show them, no, there are options. There are people who love you and care about you and who will help you. So rest in peace, Norma McCorvey. God bless you for, thank you for what you did to try to undo the damage of Roe v. Wade. When we come back, we'll be talking with Pastor Tyrone Carter about his work and ministries through Save the Black Family. This is Right to Life Radio with John Girardi, 442-1680. Give us a call. Thanks. Pastor Carter is the pastor of Ephesus Apostolic Ministries, and he is also the, what's your title with Save the Black Family, Pastor? You're the president, the grand poobah?
I'm the president, the head honcho,
the
person in charge,
the one
that you go to when something goes wrong. I mean, I accept all of that. mantle of responsibility.
See, that's how you know you're actually the boss, is that when something goes wrong, that you're the one who has to deal with it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember Dan Fouts, you know, the old quarterback for the Chargers.
Yes.
He used to walk around practice at the Chargers facility. He had this hat that it's, and it, forgive me for being, I'll censor it, don't worry. It said on it, Mother Bleeper in Charge. So was, I doubt you'd be wearing that hat, but anyway, you're the guy in charge.
John and I have to be very careful.
Exactly. Well, so do we. The FCC is listening.
I'm on the radar.
All right. So, Pastor, I want to ask you about Save the Black Family, because I think it's a very important local ministry that you're sort of spearheading here in Fresno. So what is the focus of Save the Black Family?
Well, let me just start by saying good morning, and thank you for having me on the show.
Yeah, well, thank you for being here.
Save the Black Family grew out of a group of concerned citizens who were concerned about what was going on in the African-American community. Mm-hmm. Most people don't know how devastating abortion is in the African-American community, because the African-American community is a minority community. Mm-hmm. What that means is that abortion affects us more than other communities, because they have the numbers, and the Black community is the only ethnicity that we're not replacing ourselves, but
right.
We are dwindling. We are becoming an endangered species. So Save the Black Family grew out of that logic that we've got to do something, that we've got to warn the community, educate the community, talk to the community, and let the community know what's going on.
Yeah, like one of the things I've seen, so the Centers for Disease Control said that between 2007 and 2010 that African-American children accounted for about 36% of all abortions, even though African Americans only constitute, 12% of the American population.
Yes.
So it's a thing that sort of disproportionately affects your communities, and that's not by accident. I mean, that was kind of what Margaret Sanger, who founded Planned Parenthood, that was sort of, one of her goals, wasn't it?
Yes. Yes. Margaret Sanger, who was an avowed racist, planted Planned Parenthood in the Black community because she was alarmed at the number of Black families that had large families.
Right.
And so because of eugenics, she thought that Black people were inferior and we were reproducing too fast, and she wanted to limit our numbers. So therefore, she put Planned Parenthood in the Black communities in order to solve that problem.
Mm-hmm. And it's still there. I mean, it's still very much centered around lower income minority communities.
Yes.
It's not, and some of that has to do with socioeconomics, but I think it's undeniable, regardless of what the intent is, what the impact has been. And as you say, the African American population is not replacing itself. I mean, you have to have at least, I think it's an average of 2.1 live births per couple. and that's just not happening.
Yes, yeah. And one more very important fact, John, that most people don't know is that abortion has killed more African Americans than any other causes of death.
Sure, sure, more than anything. Yeah,
15 million. So.
Right. Now, one of the things that it's not so much an issue that I see or deal with. It's I would imagine something you deal with working as pastor is, you know, how does the African American church kind of tend to grapple with the issue of abortion? Do they actually engage with it? Are they? I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, outside of the African American church, everyone's doing great. They aren't. But how do you see the African American church grappling or dealing or not dealing with the issue of abortion in this modern context?
John, I've been working in the African American community for many years to bring awareness to this subject, and it's a very difficult thing.
Right.
Most African American pastors don't want to get involved with this issue because most see it as a political issue and not a moral issue. And so after many years of trying to get an African American coalition of pastors together, finally, after all of these years, Save the Black Family has finally had an open door where mm-hmm. Black pastors are beginning to come on board to address this issue. And until we address the issue, we cannot solve the problem.
Sure. And that's the thing, like, you know, I get why a lot of pastors feel nervous and anxious about grappling with the subject, because I'd imagine in the African American, in any church context, you're going to have some members of your congregation who've had abortions, and you don't want to be offending them, and you feel nervous about how people will react because it's such a politically charged topic. But it kind of cuts both ways. I mean, that's also seems like that's a reason why you should be talking about it, because you do have people in your congregations who are hurting. And, you know, I guess my question for you is, how within the context of your ministry do you try to reach out to do you have like a specific pro-life ministry in the context of your church, or how do you try to approach that question?
Well, we don't have a specific pro-life ministry in the church. What I do is I preach it, I teach it, and I live it. The members of the church that I pastor know that I'm against abortion. I often discuss it. We often have discussions, and so all of this is intended to make people aware and to get people involved in this very volatile issue.
I'm glad that you're sort of leading the way on this question. When we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about some different political stuff that relates to the freedom that churches have to discuss political questions. Possibly we're seeing some changes from the Trump administration about, you know, IRS rules about the nonprofit status that churches have and their ability to talk about candidates and things like that. When we come back from the break, we'll have more with Pastor Tyrone Carter. 442-1680 here on AM 1680 The Answer. This is Right to Life Radio. I am John Girardi. Thanks for listening. We're talking today with Pastor Tyrone Carter from Ephesus Apostolic Ministries, who is also the director of Save the Black Family, which is a local effort in Fresno to engage the African-American community on the issue of abortion. I wanted to get in with you a little bit, Pastor Carter, because you were mentioning that the African-American community sort of views abortion as this very political question. And one of the things that President Trump has sort of brought up as an issue, and it seems like there might be some movement on it, is this thing called the Johnson Amendment. The Johnson Amendment is this part of the United States tax code. It's in the Internal Revenue Code, and it's basically the thing that says if you're a nonprofit organization or a church, you cannot endorse political candidates. And I think for years churches have used this their pastors have used this as kind of an excuse not to talk about political stuff, even though all it says is you can't endorse candidates. Basically, churches have used this as kind of a smokescreen to say, well, I don't want to talk about that. I don't want to get political. I don't want to jeopardize our nonprofit status. I want to stay away from any of that stuff. Now, I wanted to ask you, Pastor Carter, there's some discussion that President Trump might try to repeal this so that churches can actually endorse political candidates. But I wanted to ask you, Pastor Carter, how you try to approach abortion as a public question, as a political question, and how you try to educate your congregation on questions that relate to voting and how voting and the importance of the pro-life issue in your vote.
Okay. That's
a long question. Sorry. That's a long run.
It might take me the rest of the day to answer it, but I will try.
Say, I'm new to this radio thing. You got to bear with me.
Well, let me just start by saying this. During the past election and during past the elections, I have never tried to influence the people that I pastor to vote for a particular candidate. That is their God-given right. Once they go into the voting booth, it's between them, God, and their conscience. So I don't endorse that. I'm not trying to influence them. They have the right as an American citizen to cast their vote for whoever they want to vote for. I do get involved in political issues because I am an American. I want the church that I pastor to be informed about what's going on, not only in Washington, but also in Sacramento.
Right.
So it is my responsibility to keep them informed about Senate bills and all of the legislations that are coming out so that they can know what is going on in our culture and in our society.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, that's a fair way and probably the right way to approach it. I don't think the problem lies with people like – I do see, though, a lot of pastors who will – take the notion that abortion's a political issue, so I'm not going to talk about it. But that's not really what it is. It's not really so much a political issue. It's a human – it's an issue that members of their congregation are probably struggling with right now, and it's an obligation of a pastor to actually reach out and help them with those kinds of problems.
Many pastors use that as an excuse not to get involved in the issue. But I – think that, and I've talked to many black pastors, and most of them will agree wholeheartedly with me that abortion is wrong. Right. But saying that it's wrong and not getting involved in the issue, I believe is not the right way to go. We are in a time of great moral conflict, and we cannot allow ourselves to be on the sidelines. We have to get involved with what is going on. Many black pastors have their own personal issues when it comes to abortion, in that they were active. They had an active hand in
right.
abortions in their past, and they don't want their congregants to know that.
Right, and I would imagine that's another, I mean, just statistically speaking, given how many pregnancies end in abortion, there have to be a certain number of pastors who were themselves involved. And it seems like it's another one of those things that sort of cuts both ways, like that it would make you not want to talk about it. But in a sense, it puts a greater obligation on you to talk about it. I mean, sort of the Norma McCorvey thing that, you know, she was this great advocate for abortion at one point and was convicted in her conscience that no, I need to talk about this the other way now that I've gotten, you know, my mind changed on the subject.
Yes, for many pastors, it's their big secret. It's their skeleton in the closet, and so therefore they are not willing to out themselves in order to right the conflict that is going on within
right.
their own souls. So.
Right. Well. And it is interesting to see how, because of the politics of this thing, have shifted. Like, I mean, the earliest sort of stalwarts, particularly in the civil rights movement, they were all very pro-life people. I mean, you know, Martin Luther King, completely
yes.
pro-life. Even people like Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton, who today are, you know, very much, you know, proponents of the left, in their early careers were very pro-life. And I think it's such a shame that it had to become this kind of Democrat-Republican, you know, thing, and that no one can just, you know, engage with the subject as being the problem that it is, particularly in the African American community. I'm glad, Pastor, that you're sort of on the front lines doing it. What other sort of activities and outreach things are you doing through Save the Black Family?
Well, we have plans to go into African American churches and to educate. We also have we want to get into the schools. We want to get into on the college campus and talk mm-hmm. to young people about this issue, because if abortion is going to be overturned, we've got to educate this present generation about what's going on, and I think that's very important for us to do, and hopefully, and I've often say this, I hope that in my lifetime abortion will be overturned.
I hope so too. I think we're moving in the right direction, and I think at some point soon, you know, got to wait for a few Supreme Court justices to kick the bucket, but I think not that I would wish that, but
yeah, but I think, and I'm going to say this quickly, I think that one of the major things that the Trump administration can do is to defund Planned Parenthood. If we can get that done within the next year or two, that is going to be fantastic.
Okay, well, we're going to actually talk about that a little bit after our break coming up here. We're going to give a couple of legislative updates about what's going on in Washington, D.C. Pastor Carter, thank you so much for coming by.
Always.
I always appreciate it. We'll be right back here on Right to Life Radio. I'm John Girardi. This is AM 1680 The Answer. If you want to call in, 442-1680. We're going to talk about some legislation that's kicking around in Washington, D.C. and maybe some stuff in Sacramento. Please stay tuned. This is John Girardi on Right to Life Radio here on AM 1680 The Answer, 442-1680. Again, thanks to Pastor Tyrone Carter for coming on and talking about his great work at Save the Black Family. If you want to know about what we're doing at Right to Life of Central California, Right to Life of Central California is the organization that sponsors this show, and I am its executive director. We do a lot of really good things in the community to promote the pro-life message through education. If you have a church or a school or a youth group or anything that wants to get a pro-life presentation, we can talk about a number of different topics. We can talk about it from a government perspective, from a kind of religious perspective, for Catholic groups, Protestant groups, whatever. Give us a call. Our number at Right to Life of Central California is 229-2229. We'd also encourage you to take part in the special thing we're doing. It's our Valentine's Day baby drive. Yes, Valentine's Day is still going on for us. Throughout these last 2 weeks of February, we are collecting baby goods to donate to the women who are served by Fresno Pregnancy Care Center. Pregnancy Care Center is a fellow advertiser here on AM 1680 The Answer, and they do really wonderful work helping women who are facing difficult pregnancies, and they need baby stuff. They need diapers, baby clothes, new car seats, not used car seats, no perishable things like food or formula, but basically any other kind of baby stuff they can use. We have a number of different drop-off points in Fresno, including San Joaquin Memorial High School, the different offices of Pregnancy Care Center throughout the valley, and our office at Right to Life of Central California. Go to righttolifeca.org/valentine, with no S. Raphael is my buddy Raphael there is confirming that for me. He works for me at Right to Life. righttolifeca.org/valentine to get a full list of pickup locations. And please check it out. So we're going to talk real quick. I'm going to give kind of the legislative update real quick. We need more production here. We should have like some kind of like news thing, like da 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 in the background. So there's a lot of bills that are working their way through Congress. One that just passed the House of Representatives is a bill from Representative Diane Black from Tennessee. Basically, what this bill does is it allows states to defund Planned Parenthood, to take away this one source of federal funding. So states receive funding from what's called Title 10. And Title 10 concerns itself with health care funding, federal health care funding for states. And a lot of it is directed towards family planning and stuff like that. And historically, just because Planned Parenthood's the largest abortion provider in the country, a lot of that money has wound up going to Planned Parenthood. And this is money that goes from the federal government through the states to Planned Parenthood. What a lot of states have wanted to do is to say, well, we don't want this prenatal care, any of these reproductive health funds, we don't want to give them to Planned Parenthood. I mean, they're federal dollars, but they're given to us, and then we direct it to the organizations that need help. And there are a lot of states that are uncomfortable with Planned Parenthood's different practices of selling the fetal tissue of aborted children for profit, possibly. There are problems with reporting or not reporting incidents of statutory rape. So different states have wanted to redirect their funds, and they have faced a ton of resistance from the Obama administration. The Obama administration, for example, when Indiana tried to defund Planned Parenthood, the Obama administration basically said, if you do that, we're going to withdraw all of your Medicaid funding. So they basically would shake these states down and force them, you know, to continue funding Planned Parenthood. So this bill that Diane Black introduced is basically intended to counteract an executive order that President Obama issued on January 18th, like 2 days before he left office. And what Obama did was he issued this executive order saying when states receive this federal Title 10 money, they are not allowed to kind of pick and choose. And basically it was an executive order designed to keep states from being able to divert Title 10 funds away from Planned Parenthood. What Diane Black is doing in Congress right now is trying to reverse that, and she's not going to just sit around and wait for President Trump to issue an executive order reversing what Obama's doing. She's passing this congressional resolution saying, we think that that executive order needs to be reversed. She'll pass it through the House, then it'll pass through the Senate, and then it'll go to the president's desk, and he can sign it like an executive order. So that would be a really cool thing. This isn't the big defunding of Planned Parenthood. The big defunding of Planned Parenthood will take place when Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, the President Obama's big healthcare reform, when the Republicans repeal and replace that, that is when they will defund Planned Parenthood, and I really hope that happens. But this is attacking about, you know, $200 million of different governmental funding, this is our hope that, you know, a big chunk of money that goes through the states to Planned Parenthood will be cut off, and then the bigger chunk of money that comes directly from the federal government through the Medicaid program, that will be cut off when Congress passes their Affordable Care Act repeal. Speaking of the Affordable Care Act, we're in kind of a difficult place with it right now. And I'm going to put on Right to Life's Facebook page, and we'll probably link to it on our Twitter account and my personal Twitter account, at John V. Girardi, a really great op-ed piece by Representative Joe Pitts, former Representative Joe Pitts from Pennsylvania, who was a really conservative pro-life guy, talking about the need that how the Republicans need to structure a replacement for Obamacare. Basically, there's a fear that the replacement Republican plan will provide some kinds of tax credits, or which is sort of a conservative way to hide something that's actually a subsidy. You call it a tax credit and it's magically not liberal anymore. Tax credits for abortion, for healthcare plans that cover abortion. Funding for healthcare plans that cover abortion is one of the things that leads to the most dramatic increase in numbers of abortion. And so what we need to ensure is that whatever plan the Republicans introduce to replace Obamacare, that it include absolutely no funding for abortion or for healthcare plans that cover abortion. So we'll link to that on Right to Life's Facebook page. You can check it out. This is Right to Life Radio. I am John Girardi. We'll be right back after this break. 442-1680. Right before we go, I'm going to talk very quickly about a bill that I think I will be talking with Jonathan Keller about tomorrow on the Jim Franklin Live show, where I think I'll be filling in. SB 18. This is a California state bill that purports to give a statement of basically a charter of the rights of children here in the state of California. And it sounds really nice, and it says that all children have a right to parents and guardians and caregivers who act in their best interest, for children to have the right to live in a safe and healthy environment, the right to social and emotional well-being, the right to opportunities to attain optimal cognitive, physical, and social development. They have the right to all of these things that are not very well defined, and they're very broad, and they're very nebulous. Like, what is the best interest of the child to which they have a right? What does it mean to have a safe and healthy environment? It's a very nebulous bill that wouldn't, I think, actually do much. But the problem is that it would establish a kind of legal precedent for judges in later days to look at existing laws that could be passed and say, this isn't what we think is in the child's best interest. And the thing that I think is chiefly troubling for pro-lifers is, you know, what if you are a pro-life parent of a child who gets pregnant and you're trying to convince your child not to have an abortion? What if you are a Christian school that does not offer the kinds of sex ed or pro-abortion health services or educational services that, for example, the state of California would want you to impose? It's a very scary bill. It's very nebulous, and it could have some really bad impacts. That's all for us here at Right to Life Radio. This is John Girardi. This is AM 1680, The Answer. God bless. Thank you so much.